Hello, today we're covering exceptional control flow and how operating systems use exceptional control flow to implement an abstraction called the process that is again an abstraction provided by the operating system to enable user programs. So most control flow is sequential. In other words, you always go to the next instruction afterwards. That's what happens most of the time while code is executing. We've seen minor exceptions to this so far in the form of jumps and procedure calls, but these are caused by changes in the internal program state. And so they're relatively predictable from the perspective of the program writer. However, we've also seen some violations of this rule. So here we're talking about control flow changes in response to external factors. So for instance, you saw exceptions in Java and you saw the infamous seg faults in C. So exceptions violate sequential control flow and they result in an unconditional transfer to another location in the code. This is sometimes partially implemented in hardware and partially implemented in software. So this is again a place where the operating system kind of crosses the boundary between hardware and software. Exceptions are often the result of an error condition, but not necessarily. In fact, we're going to see how the operating system uses exceptions in order to implement time sharing, which is allowing multiple programs to run on the same CPU by sort of switching between them as they're running. So we categorize exceptions in a couple of different ways. One way is asynchronous versus synchronous, and this is about whether it happens as a result of an external source or not. So if it's coming from outside the program, it's asynchronous. If it's the result of something that the program does, we call it synchronous. We also categorize exceptions by the possibility of recovery. So some exceptions always return back to where the exception happened. Some of the exceptions sometimes return, and then some of the exceptions never return, ever. And then finally, if recovery is possible, then the exceptions are further categorized by recovery location. So where do you go back to? Do you try to execute the same instruction again, or do you go to the next instruction? So the first type of exception is an interrupt, and this is basically a communication mechanism. These are asynchronous, and they always return to the next instruction. So this is usually the result of some sort of hardware event. So for instance, an I/O operation has finished, or a keyboard button has been pressed, or a mouse button, or something like that. And so what happens here is that there's actually a hardware event that happens, and it sets the interrupt pin to go high during the execution of a particular instruction. When that instruction is done, the control passes to the interrupt handler, and the interrupt handler does whatever it needs to do to handle that, and then the handler returns the control to the next instruction after the one where the interrupt occurred. So this sort of interrupts execution, and again, this is often the result of an I/O operation, but we'll also see in a minute how this is used by the operating system to switch between processes once one process has finished its time slice, its portion of time that's been allotted to it on the CPU. The next kind of exception is a trap. So this is an intentional control transfer to the kernel. So this is synchronous. This is the result of the program choosing to transfer control to the kernel. They almost always return to the next instruction. They're almost like a function call in some ways, except that it's not a call to somewhere else inside the program. It's a call to somewhere in the kernel or the operating system. These are also, because of that, also referred to as system calls. So in x86-64, this happens using the syscall instruction, and the ID of the particular system call that's being invoked is transferred using the RAX register. Like parameter passing in regular functions, you can pass parameters to system calls using particular registers, and those system calls can also return a value, again, using RAX, just like with a regular procedure call. And there are well-known standards for how these operating system calls are supposed to work. So POSIX is one such set of standards. The final type of a, or I'm sorry, the second to last type of exception is the fault. So this is an error that is potentially correctable. So this is synchronous. It happens as a result of something that the program does. And sometimes it returns back to the same instruction, but only sometimes. So here are a couple examples of faults. So the first one that we've seen is a page fault. So this is the result of a cache miss in virtual memory. So you try to access a page that hasn't been loaded. and so you have a page fault. This is recoverable, right? Because you can go out to the disk or wherever the memory, wherever the page is being stored in a lower level of cache perhaps, and you can load it in. And so this is an example of recoverable fault. So after the page is loaded, then control is transferred back to the same instruction, right? Because now you want to be able to read that memory and execute the instruction. A segmentation fault, the infamous problem that you've been dealing with all semester. This is another example of a fault. This is an invalid memory access. It's something that's the result of something that a user program does. And these are not recoverable. The program would have undefined behavior if we tried to go back and execute the same instruction again, because this is something you just can't fix. And another example of this, just for illustration purposes, is a divide by zero error. So this is an undefined result. And again, this is not recoverable. The program will crash if you attempt to do this. Okay, so the final kind of exception is an abort. And this is an unrecoverable error. This is synchronous, generally in response to something that the program does, and this never returns. This is just a fatal error. You likely won't encounter these this semester. This is more common when you're working closer to the hardware and perhaps in embedded systems. So the one example that your textbook provides is interrupt number 18, which is referred to as a machine check. It's basically just a fatal hardware error. So those are the types of exceptions, and in the next couple of videos, we'll explore how the operating system uses these to implement processes.